Today we have Satyaki Chowdhury from NISER Bhubaneswar, and he's a master student. He's doing master's there. He's going to present his project, whatever he presented in his master's course in quantum information theory course. He's going to present the same talk here as well. The title of the talk is Efficiency of a Quantum Otto Heat Engine Operating Under a Reservoir at Negative Temperatures. And it is based on this PRL paper, whatever he pointed here, PRL 122.240.602.2019. Guys, you can download and check that what kind of paper he's talking about. And like I asked him to give this talk here as well, because we are also interested to do something with finite temperature field theory and its application in different regimes. So this can be a nice option to talk in this meeting. So Satyaki is going to talk about this thing. So please, Satyaki, you just continue with your talk.
Thank you, sir. So the title of the talk is Efficiency of a Quantum Otto Heat Engine Operating Under a Reservoir at Negative Temperatures. It is actually based on an experiment which the author performed using a reservoir at negative temperatures. So here is the outline of my talk.
No, my first of all question is why you haven't written your affiliation in the first slide. Don't you think so it should be written, NISER Bhubaneswar? What kind of slide you have written here?
Sorry, sir. Actually, this is my first time, so I do not have any idea how to prepare slide and all. So I'm sorry if any mistakes occur. I'm not able to skip to the next slide.
Okay, you have to go to the slideshow, I think.
Yes, I have opened slideshow.
Nah, you haven't opened the slideshow. You just go back. Go to the option. And there is something called slideshow.
Wait, I'm not able to. Sorry. So here is the outline of my talk. So before explaining the experiment, what the authors actually did, I would first like to introduce an Otto engine. Then I would like to do a comparison between the classical and the quantum heat engine. Following that, I will introduce the concept of negative temperature. After doing that, I will explain the experimental setup and some of the theoretical and experimental observations. And finally, I'll end my talk with some conclusions that the author actually got after performing the experiment. So what is an Otto engine? It is basically an idealized thermodynamics cycle, just like a Carnot engine. We all are familiar with Carnot engine. Otto engine is similar, is a similar cyclic process like a Carnot engine. The only difference is that
I just want to know what is Carnot engine, why engine
yes,
is
bad,
why thermodynamic engines are important. Explain.
I'll tell. So the main difference between a Carnot engine and Otto engine is that a Carnot engine consists of two adiabatic and two isothermal processes. And an Otto engine consists of two adiabatic, which is similar to that of Carnot engine, and two isochoric engine. Now we know adiabatic processes are those in which heat exchange is not there, or no heat exchange is there between the system and the surroundings. And isochoric process, we call the process isochoric if the volume remains constant throughout the experiment or throughout the time we consider the system. And what was your question, sir?
I'm saying that why this concept of thermodynamic engine is important, start from that.
Sir, actually, Carnot engine was probably when scientists were looking for heat engines, then Carnot engine was basically developed from that. We want a system which can operate in some way or the other and extract some kind of work. Our aim is to perform some operation and extract some work from the heat engine. Like there will be reservoirs. We want to implement some kind of machines and extract the work just by utilizing the temperature difference between the reservoir. So this, I think, basically was the main aim of thermodynamic engine.
Okay.
Well, now I would like to differentiate between a classical and a quantum heat engine. So what is a classical engine? In the classical engine, the working substance which is used is basically a fluid. It can be a gas or a liquid, and it is filled in a cylinder which is connected with a piston. Now the movement of the piston during the expansion and the contraction process is actually used to derive that work from that system. Now here lies the main difference between the classical and the quantum heat engine. In the quantum engine, what happens, the working substance, it need not have any classical analog. Like, to understand this, let us take the example of a spin half system in the magnetic field. If you can see the figure, that the spin half system in magnetic field, in the left hand side of the picture, you can see that the system is in a low magnetic field region, and some of the particles are in the low energy state and some are in the high energy state. Now what happens if we take the system from the low magnetic field region to the high magnetic field region? Then some of the particles will transmit, it will go from the lower energy state to the higher energy state. Now if by some way we can extract the energy which is released during this transition, then we can construct a heat engine out of that. So this is basically the main aim of a quantum heat engine. It utilizes a multi-level energy system as its working agent.
Okay.
So now what is the concept of negative temperature?
Guys, you have any question out of that, whatever he said? George, Golam, and who's the other guy? Abhinash. Surprising, there is no question. Proceed.
Not it.
Okay. So now let me introduce the concept of negative temperature. So the better understanding of negative temperature can be through an example. So let me give you an example. So let us consider a system having n energy levels. Okay, having n energy levels. We know that the number of particles in any energy level.
Just before explaining this, just tell me, what do you mean by negative temperature?
Yes, sir. I'll tell you. Will get to know the origin of negative temperature from this example.
No, I don't want to know the example. I just want to ask you, what do you mean physically by negative temperature? What physics tell you about negative? temperature.
So if any system, okay, has energy greater than the, if you can, you can see that in the Kelvin scale, in the Kelvin scale, any system which is hotter, which is actually hotter than the other system, can be considered as a system with negative temperature.
Mm-hmm.
Like in physical systems, where does the concept of negative temperature arises? In any kind of system where the higher energy state is more populated than the lower energy state.
Okay.
Okay. So it will be clear if I give you this example. Okay.
Achha, negative temperature, is that mean negative entropy?
No, sir. Negative entropy, not like that. Actually, when you increase the system, when any kind of system, suppose you increase the energy, the entropy of the system will increase. Okay. Now, if it happens that by increasing the energy, the entropy of the system can be decreased again, then concept of negative temperature will arise. I will explain this precisely with the example of a spin half system in magnetic field, and I'll show the graph as well, how it arises.
Okay,
so let us take the example of a system having n energy levels. Okay, so we know that the number of particles in the ith energy level is proportional to the Boltzmann factor, which is e to the power minus ei by kt. So let's say there are n1 number of particles in the lower energy state and n2 number of particles in the higher energy state. So if you express the temperature of the system in terms of the energy difference between the two states, you can see that if the higher energy state has greater number of particles than the number of particles in the lower energy state, the system will be in negative temperature. A better understanding can be done through this graph. I will explain this graph with the help of an example, which is the spin half system in a magnetic field. So when, let's say we have spin half system in the presence of a magnetic field. When the magnetic field is zero, let's say the energy of the system is zero. Okay, is zero. Now when you introduce the magnetic field, what happens? The energy level will get splitted depending on the... Any questions, sir?
No.
Okay. So if we introduce some magnetic field, what will happen? The energy level will get splitted depending on whether the system, on the particles are aligned parallel or anti-parallel to the magnetic field. Now, when all the particles, let's say, are aligned parallel to the magnetic field, the energy of the system will be minimum. You can see this from the graph, left hand side will be minimum, and it is a highly ordered system. Why I'm saying this? That it is a highly ordered system because all the particles are pointing in the same direction, in the direction of the magnetic field. So it is a highly ordered system. So the entropy of the system will be zero, as we know that entropy is actually the measurement of the amount of disorderedness of the system. So the entropy of the system will be zero. If you can see the left hand picture, I'm talking about the point at the extreme left, where E is, at for some value of E, S is zero. Okay. So now let us take the other extreme end. So when all the particles will point
from where you got this kind of symmetric distribution,
sir, the example I'm giving actually will correspond to this graph.
I can understand, but how you know that this is kind of a symmetric distribution?
Sir, by the nature, I can explain that how this symmetric nature is arising.
Okay, tell.
Okay. You got the case of the extreme left point, no?
Yes.
Where S is zero at some value of E.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, now let's take the other extreme end where for some value of E, S is again zero. This case corresponds to when all the particles are aligned anti-parallel to the magnetic field. Then the energy of the system is highest. But this is again a highly ordered system as all the particles are pointing in the same direction. So again, the entropy of the system will be zero. Now, for some particular value of configuration, let's say N1 particles pointing parallel to the magnetic field and an N2 number of particles pointing and anti-parallel to the magnetic field, the entropy will be maximum. For when all the particles point parallel to the magnetic field, it is a highly ordered system, entropy is zero. Again, when all the particles point anti-parallel to the magnetic field, it is also a highly ordered system and the entropy of the system is again zero.
Okay.
Now, for some particular configuration, let's say even number of particles, half number of particles parallel and half number of particles anti-parallel. This is a highly disordered system, the most disordered system which can occur. In that case, the entropy will be highest or the maximum.
Mm-hmm.
So this actually corresponds to the, again, when we shift the system, let's say we increase the energy, then again the again some of the particles will reorient themselves and the entropy of the system will decrease. So away from the maximum, again the system entropy decreases. Is there any question?
No.
Okay. So now let's see the other figure, how this arises. We know from statistical mechanics that T is equals to 1 by T is equals to del S by del U. Okay. Where U is the energy of the system. So when the entropy of the system is zero, temperature will be zero.
Mm-hmm.
When entropy is maximum, del S by del U is zero. It is the maxima.
Del S by del U. You are dividing del S divided by del U.
Yes, sir. It is the maxima condition that the first derivative of S with respect to E in this case, if you see the...
No, but then why you were saying del S by del U?
Oh, del S del U. Sorry. That is the maximum condition. Okay, that is, I'm sorry. Okay. So when the entropy is maximum, its first derivative with respect to E is zero. And so if we follow this definition, that del S by del S del E is equals to
is, the bad part is you have written so many things in your slides. It's not
sir, actually I'm sorry, this is actually the slide which I prepared for the talk I had to give in the class. So our instructor actually instructed, no, actually all these portions were some of the questions which was asked to me, and he asked to include all those answers in the slides later. I had to send him the PDF of my talk.
That is different issue, but you are giving a seminar and you are writing each and every explanation, word, sentences. It is like a mess, complete mess.
No, sir. Actually, I said that these are actually some of the questions which were asked to me, and he asked to...
Then why you haven't edited before giving...
Yes, sir. Yes, I did not get the time to edit, actually. I'm sorry for that. I'm really sorry for that.
You are the most busiest person after our Prime Minister, I think.
No, sir. It's not like that. I'm sorry for that.
Yeah, proceed.
Okay. So
if you make your slides too much like that, then it is sometimes difficult to follow the content. So please make it like very clean. Like, yes. have you seen that how good talk George had given earlier, his slides and all?
No, sir. Actually, this is my first time, so I have no experience of giving talk. So I'm sorry for that.
These are just silly excuses. I just don't care. Okay, proceed.
Okay, so when the entropy is maximum, as you can see, then the condition 1 by T, which is equals to del S by del S del E, is 0. And so the temperature is infinite, or it diverges. Okay, now if you see the negative portion, the slope is actually negative. So in this case, the plot is just the reverse. It's just the reverse of that obtained for the other half. So from the second plot, it is clear that as the energy increases, we can see that the temperature is actually negative. It is having negative values. So if we can construct any kind of system which obeys this kind of entropy distribution, we can actually have systems with negative temperatures. Okay. Now, what was the objective of the paper? The authors actually performed an experiment to show that the efficiency of a quantum heat engine, which is operating under reservoir at negative temperature, its efficiency is actually greater than its classical counterpart. So now, let me tell you about the experimental setup which the authors actually have used to implement the quantum Otto heat engine. The sample they used was acetone, CHCl3, and they diluted it. Now the purpose of dilution was to separate out the carbon and the hydrogen nucleus spins separately so that they can be viewed as two independent qubit systems. Now, the nuclear spin of the carbon atom will act as the working medium in this case, and the sea of spins of the hydrogen nucleus will act as the hot thermal reservoir. And they obviously used a spectrometer, a variance spectrometer, which they used to vary the frequency to control the population of the hot and the cold reservoir. Now, what are the four strokes of the quantum Otto heat engine? The first is the cooling stroke, then comes the expansion stroke. I'll explain what happens in each of this stroke, but to name them, first comes the cooling stroke, then is the expansion stroke, then again we apply the heating stroke, and finally the compression stroke. Now, what happens in the cooling stroke? First, this is the actually the square in the center is actually the working substance, and which in this case is the nuclear spin of the carbon atom. Okay, so what happens in the cooling stroke? In the cooling stroke, by using magnetic fields and varying the frequency, the state of the carbon nucleus is brought into row 1. It is brought in contact with the cold reservoir, and it is driven into the state row 1. Okay, now what happens in the expansion stroke? Now the expansion stroke is given for a very short amount of time. What happens due to this short amount of time, the process, that is the process of taking the system from the cooling stroke to the expansion stroke, it can be described by a unitary operator. Okay, the process can be considered as almost unitary. So the state of the system after the expansion stroke is given by this rho 2. Okay, and we know that in the Heisenberg picture, operator evolves in this way. Now comes the heating stroke. What happens in this heating stroke is that they apply time varying frequency fields, that is frequency which varies with time. They apply that, and the system is brought in thermal equilibrium with the temperature of the hot reservoir, and the state of the system after this process is given by this rho 3. Okay, and so finally comes the compression stroke. In this stroke, what happens? Exactly the protocol which was observed, which was implemented in the expansion stroke, it is just reversed.
In the figure, it should be rho 4. You have written rho 3 again.
Oh, sorry, sir. I did not notice that. I'm sorry.
Obvious. And also, the unitary operations are different, actually.
Yes, sir. It is U and it is V.
Yeah, but what are the form of the unitary operators for two different cases?
Sir, actually the V, which ultimately is given in the last step.
Is it e to the power minus I, H cold and H hot, T by H cross, or something else?
E to the power minus unitary operator. The operator, yes sir, it can be like
can
like
be
that they have No, actually, I'm
option.
Telling you. Huh?
This is the only option. Can be option.
Yes, sir. That is only the thing. But the thing I want to explicitly show that is that operator, unitary operator V is actually the Hermitian conjugate of that U.
Mm-hmm.
And one more thing, in this case, the cooling and the heating stroke are actually the isochoric processes, and the expansion and the cooling ones are the adiabatic.
Now, why this U and V are Hermitian? Mane, like conjugate to each other?
Sir, because in this case, in coming from the step 2 to 3, you can see that the system is actually brought in contact with the thermal reservoir and it is brought in some equilibrium condition.
So if you are saying that they are conjugate to each other, then what is the relation between the frequency of the hot reservoir and the cold reservoir? What is the relation between them?
Sir, actually the frequency, which you can see that new hot and new cold, they actually control the population of this.
I can understand.
Nuclear spin.
If you say that U is equal to V dagger.
Yes, sir.
Okay, or V is equal to U dagger. From that, what kind of constraint you will get from the system? I'm asking.
That, sir, I have not thought about it. I'll think about it and answer you, sir. I'll think about it and answer you. Right.
And also, what is the total density matrix of the system? Is it sum of all or the product of all?
Sir, it will be, it should be that. No. 1 minute, sir. Sir, these four processes are independent of each other. So, at a particular instant of time, this row 1, row 2, row 3, and row 4 are the density matrices of the total system at a particular instant of time. After the cooling stroke, the density matrix is given by this one, this row 1. After the expansion stroke, the density matrix is row 2. Similarly, like that, at a particular instant of time, we have a certain density matrix, which is actually the density matrix of the entire system, of the entire working agent here.
Mm-hmm.
Like, we cannot say that there is some row which is row 1 plus row 2.
I can understand. These are, you can think about some subsystems, row 1, row 2, row 3, row 4. So I'm asking, if why you want to write down the total density of the whole thing, then how
on? No, I'm saying that they are not the density matrices of any subsystem. They are the density matrix of the entire system at a particular instant of time. Like, say, after you apply the cooling stroke, the entire system is characterized by the density matrix row 1. Similarly,
then tell me how row 1, row 2, row 3, row 4 are connected. What is the relation between row 1, row 2, row 3, row 4? I'm asking, what is the mathematical relation between them?
Sir, the density matrix actually, you know, here I've written that row 2 is actually unitary, like unitary evolution of row 1. It's Like that. Now you can see that you can
I'm
write
saying,
row one.
can you write down a single operation through which you can explain how row 1 goes to row 2 and row 2 goes to row 3 goes to row 4 and row 4
Sir,
goes to row 1?
You just need to replace row 1 here by the expression this. Like you, I'm saying that you cannot express the entire system at a particular instant, let's say, with a density matrix having all this, because they are all independent processes. At a particular instant, you can describe the system by a particular density matrix.
And how you can able to get from row 4 to row 1?
Row 4 to row 1. Sir, it is basically again the same cyclic order we are going. Again, when we suppose the state of the system after the compression stroke is...
No, that's why I'm saying, can you able to establish, can you give me some sets of constraints which will show that it is automatically cyclic?
No, sir, actually...
Because there are two operations, U and V, involved. Now, you have to do the thing in such a way that there should be some constraint which will say you that this is a cyclic combination.
No, after the compression stroke, actually...
There is nothing actually, man. You have to...
As you can see, sir, that the Hamiltonian H cold... in the fourth stage, that is after the compression stroke, the Hamiltonian of the system is similar to that of row.
So what? Hamiltonian is same, but I'm saying that how you perform the operation on row four so that it will go to row one again. What will going to happen to V1, V operator?
Mm-hmm. I understand your question.
Because row three contains the hot degrees of freedom. Now you apply V, that will give you row four. Now you have to do some operation which will give you row one. So what is that operation? I'm asking. What is going to happen? What is going to happen to the hot degrees of freedom, which will transfer hot degrees of freedom to the cold one? What kind of constraint it is? I want to ask.
I have a question.
Who's that?
Abhinash, hi. So this similar thing, like for row 2 to row 3, okay, so there is no connection. I don't see any connection. Like, so you went from row 1 to row 2, but then row 2 to row 3, how did you go? That's another question I have.
The same thing I have asked. Row 2 to 3, the same thing, and also row 4 to row 1.
And another question I have. So you are saying U and V, they are conjugate to each other, complex conjugate to each other. So my question is, how are you saying that they are complex conjugate to each other? Is there a constraint, or like, so basically a row 2 equal to row 4 dagger or something? So,
see, the basically the processes 2 to 3, okay, and 4 to 1 are isochoric ones. Okay, so after you apply the expansion stroke, you reach at row 2. Okay, then what happens? You perform some operations, you bring the system in thermal equilibrium with the hot reservoir, and we obtain the state at row 3. See, our aim is to find out the efficiency of this circle, we are not concerned what happens during the process 2 to 3. We just want what is the state of the system after the entire process has been carried out. We are not concerned what happens during the process. We just want what is the state of the system after the process, so that we can find out that is there any work done during the process or not. So I think they have not.
You didn't got what Abhinash said. Abhinash said that he is not interested whatever in between is going on, but you can able to know the final thing if you know the proper operation only.
Okay, I think so basically 1 to 2 is a cooling process and 3 to 4 is the expansion process. Okay.
No. 1 to 2 is the expansion process and 3 to 4 is the compression process.
Compression. Okay. Okay. So what I'm trying to say is U is basically your work done. So you cannot just for expansion and compression, you have to work.
Sorry,
on
I
your
didn't
system.
Get you. Abhinash, can you repeat?
I'm saying for expansion and compression, you have to work on your system, okay? And U is basically that work. This is what I think, okay? And for isochoric, the work done is zero. Okay, so basically you let the system evolve from 2 to 3 and 4 to 1. You just let the system evolve. Okay, this is what I think. Okay, so there is no operation at row 3 and row 1. Basically, U and V are your basically work you are doing on the system. This is what I think. Now I want to hear your comments.
No, but yeah. I'm asking that what is the relation between row 4 and row 1 and row 2 and row 3?
How do we get row 3 from row 2?
Because you have shown an arrow. That arrow means they are connected actually. It is not a disconnected process.
Yes, sir. After we reach row 2, okay, the thing I want to convey is that after we reach row 2.
No, you whatever you want to convey, I can, but can you able to show me how from row 2 you get row 3? If I want to know.
Sir, how it is coming that I actually don't know. Actually, I'm not sure that from this is coming. But what happens, the arrow actually indicates that after this process, after we reach row 2, we give the system, we bring the system in thermal contact with the hot reservoir, and we obtain after the state row 2.
I am not I can understand what you want to convey. I'm saying that whatever you have said, can you able to write down a statement, operational statement, which gives you row 2 to row 3? It should be there. Some operational statement should be there. You are talking about by quantum mechanics, man. There should be some operational statement.
Okay, sir. I'll get back to you then.
Just let me know that how you can able to connect row 3 with row 2 and similarly row 4 with row 1.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Then I can able to understand the whole thing, what is going on actually. And okay, also, you can able to tell about the cyclicity also. If you know that how it is going on, then you can able to understand this is a cyclic process actually.
Okay, sir. Okay. Okay, sir. I'll get back to you on this.
Okay.
So, now here are some of the theoretical calculations that we obtain the density matrices after each stage. So from this we can calculate the work done during the entire process,
How you have calculated? How you have calculated? Go to the next slide.
Sir, here just the final expressions are given. If you want to see the entire calculation, it's given here. That as I said that the expansion stroke and the compression stroke work is actually done during these two processes. So if we have the density matrices after each stage, we can calculate the work done, which is equivalent to the loss in energy. Suppose let's say at the cooling stroke the system's energy was E1, and after it reached stage 2 its energy is E2 and the energy is less or more anything, then we can find out the work which is actually extracted from the engine. In this way the derivation can be shown, that how it comes. Okay, so if you can see this expression of average work which is extracted from the system, and this is the expression why, of the
why you have like taken mod of beta.
Which one, sir?
Why beta hot mod?
Achha, sir. Beta hot is mod because beta hot is actually in this case, as I said, the negative temperature. At negative temperature, to show that I have taken the modulus sign here.
No, I didn't.
As you can remember that.
I didn't get you. If it is negative, then why should you shouldn't take the negative sign?
Okay. I'll tell you. If you can see this, as I've written here, that if you consider the actual Kelvin scale, the system which actually has greater energy or which is actually hotter, this can be considered as a system at effective negative temperature. The system, the temperature of the system is actually not minus in that case. It is at effective negative temperature. Okay, actually the hotter of the two systems is in some kind of effective negative temperature. This I think it appears in some context of NMR and laser physics, which I'm not so familiar with. I am explaining on what I understood actually. So
okay, no problem, just proceed.
Okay, so if you can see now, please focus on the first expression, which is actually the expression for the average work which is extracted from the cycle. We can see that this parameter zeta, which is actually the transition probability between the eigenstates, it actually gives us information about the speed, or the rate at which the expansion and the compression stages are carried out. It actually gives us some information about the non-adiabaticity which is present in the system. Now we can see that this expression zeta can actually be used to increase the amount of work which is extracted from the system. And this is what the authors actually observed. In the classical case, this parameter zeta is zero. In the quantum version, this term arises, and this zeta is the transition probability, which actually can be used to increase the amount of work which is extracted from the system. Okay.
So it's basically you are writing some kind of S matrix, and from that you want to calculate the transition probability.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
So now. Hello.
Yeah,
So I have
yeah.
seen Satyaki, so zeta,
Avinash.
so that
Yes, yes,
vector
yes.
you have, that eigen vector you have, go back one slide, please. So the probability you have, so the eigen vector you have is basically minus plus code and plus minus
Cold.
hot. Okay,
Yes.
can you just explicitly tell me what do you mean by plus hot and minus hot and plus code and minus
See,
code?
these are actually basically the eigenstates of the hot and the cold reserve, where they have actually used the symbol. I have taken this from
Oh,
the
okay.
paper
H.
itself.
Okay. You have H code and H hot. So,
Yes,
yeah.
exactly. These are the eigenstates of this Hamiltonian, H cold and H hot. Okay.
Fine. Understood.
So now, if we can see, and another thing, that the average work, if we want to extract the work from the system, it will have a constraint on zeta, and this is this one, the expression I've written here. So we got that from the theoretical calculations. We got that zeta is actually the transition probability between the eigenstates of the Hamiltonian, H cold and H hot, and it gives us some kind of idea about the non-adiabaticity, or the rate at which the expansion and the compression stages are carried out. So now one plot here the authors have got this from the experiment itself. I've taken this from the paper, is how zeta varies with the driving time. And you can see this, that as the driving time is lesser, zeta is greater. Okay, so if you carry the expansion and the compression strokes faster enough, so you can you increase the amount of work extracted. Any questions?
No.
Yes, it's basically, I think it's basically like a piston moving very fast, like that.
Yes, if you consider the classical analog, now in this case, in the quantum case, what happens? We do not consider, we do not model the engine like that, like a piston carrying out containing some kind of fluid, and it is moving faster like that. The transition, actually, if you were present earlier, as I showed that in the spin-off
Yes,
system,
yes.
you carry the, what happens? You move the system faster enough from the region of low magnetic field to the high magnetic field. It is
Okay.
like that. Okay. Okay.
Okay, fine.
So we got that if we increase the speed, or we decrease the time, the driving time of carrying out the expansion and the compression strokes, then we can actually increase the amount of extracted work. This is what the authors have actually done, and they have plotted something, and they have showed that indeed, if we carry out the expansion and the compression strokes faster, then we can increase the amount of extracted work. Another thing, as the time increases, the extracted work increases. So basically, what happens? The power of the system increases. The power of the quantum Otto heat engine actually increases, can be increased from the
Power,
classical.
power or efficiency?
Sir, efficiency can also be increased. And power, why I'm telling? Because power is actually, if we follow the classical definition, it is work by time. As time is lesser, work is greater. So the power will increase.
Okay.
Okay, sir. And this was the main, actually the main encouraging factor for the construction of the quantum version of the heat engine. And so now, after you calculate, you have that expression for W and you have that expression for the heat extracted from the hot reservoir. You can calculate the efficiency, which is defined as the ratio of the work extracted from the heat engine to the heat absorbed from the hot reservoir. You can see that the expression of the efficiency comes out to be this, and it actually depends on the frequency applied, the frequency new cold and new hot which is actually applied. Now in this case we can see again that if in the classical case that transition probability, that factor zeta is zero, so the classical expression is 1 minus new cold by new hot, and in the quantum case zeta is non-zero, we have some term involving zeta. So you can see that zeta can actually be used to increase the amount of extracted work, it can be used to increase the power of the heat engine, and it can be used to increase the efficiency of the heat engine as well.
Okay.
So here and now, here are some of the plots which the author actually got after the experiment. If you see the left hand side figure, you can see that the black line corresponds to the one in which the driving time is least. Okay, it corresponds to something around 100 microseconds. You can see that for the least driving time, or when the time during which the expansion and the compression strokes are carried out is least, the efficiency after the classical regime, this intersection point is the classical regime. Okay, so after that you can see that the driving time, when it is the least, the efficiency of the system is the highest. Okay, and as the time increases, the efficiency decreases. And now in the second figure, they have plotted the efficiency and they have varied the frequency. Actually, they have varied the frequency new hot, which they use to control the population of the hot reservoir. Okay. So you can see in this case that if the frequency is greatest, then the efficiency is also greatest. That violet color line, it actually corresponds to the greatest frequency. Okay, it is also clear from this expression that if new hot is larger, this term 1 minus this term will be lesser, then this neta or the efficiency will be greater. Okay. So we concluded that the non-adiabaticity parameter zeta, or which can be considered as the rate at which the expansion and the compression strokes are carried out, it can be actually used to increase the amount of extracted work, it can be used to increase the efficiency of the heat engine, and it can also be used to increase the power of the heat engine. So this was the main encouraging factor, that if we have two reservoirs, one at positive temperature and the other at a negative temperature, then the efficiency of the heat engine is actually greater than when the both the reservoirs are at positive temperature. Okay, now I want to show you some of my plots which I have plotted. These are actually the what I told that Boltzmann factor, the relation beta cold or hot, that is the temperature of the hot and the cold reservoir is actually controlled by the frequency nu cold and nu hot, and I have plotted it in this case. And another thing, this one is the most important one, as I have claimed that if we increase zeta or the transition probability, then the average work which we extract from the system actually increases. And it is indeed the case. If you plot the expression of the work done, of the work extracted from the system with the transition probability, it actually increases. Then another one, the heat absorbed. If you plot the heat absorbed with...
Abhinash, have a probe question.
Yes, sir.
So basically, can you go back to your expressions of average W and average Q?
Uh-huh. Yes.
The expressions.
Just a second.
Okay. Here you have basically linear in zeta.
Yes.
So basically, that's what you're getting there. So yes.
I have to say, this is not very important, but this is also very important. You have used here xi and plotted zeta. There is a difference between xi and zeta, actually.
Yeah.
I didn't get you, sir. I didn't get you. Can you repeat, please? Oh, no, actually. Oh, I'm sorry. Actually, this symbol actually comes in Mathematica. I don't know. Actually, they correspond to the same thing.
You are wrong. You have substituted zeta. That's why. In Mathematica, there is xi as well.
Okay. I'm sorry for that. I'm sorry for all these silly mistakes. I'm sorry. Okay, so if you see the plot of the heat absorbed with the transition probability, you can see that it actually increases. Now with zeta, average work increases and heat absorbed decreases. So if efficiency is W by Q, W increases, Q decreases. So efficiency indeed increases. Okay. Now, again, if we plot the efficiency with the transition probability zeta and at different frequencies nu hot, okay. So you can see that at greater frequencies nu hot, the efficiency will be greater, as we already saw from this expression. Where is that? Here. If nu hot is greater, the second term will be lesser, and so the efficiency will be greater. Okay. And so finally, another thing that again, now I have plotted the efficiency with nu cold, the other term, and I saw that again I kept nu hot fixed. So again, when nu hot is larger, the efficiency at varying with the nu cold at a fixed value of nu hot, the efficiency will decrease. Okay, if you keep nu cold fixed at a certain value, then you can see for the greatest value of nu hot, the efficiency is greatest. Okay. These are the things which I have plotted to see that if indeed from the expression this comes. And here is the detailed derivation of all the expressions. Thank you, everyone. If you have any question, please ask.
Okay, so I have one question. Basically, can I go back to your slide where you have plotted entropy with respect to energy?
Entropy, sure. Entropy with respect to energy, Avinash.
So here, so you are assuming that your entropy is basically always positive, right? I mean, this is
Yeah.
I mean, your right hand side, in the right hand side, your slope is negative, which gives you negative temperature. Okay.
Yes.
So
yes.
This totally. This is basically your graph is like concave downwards. Concave downwards. That's why you're getting a negative slope there.
Yes.
If your graph would have been like convex downward, then you would have got a positive slope there. But yeah, mm-hmm. On the left hand side, you would have got a negative temperature. Okay, so yeah, I understood my point. Like that's fine. Another thing. So you have at the maximum entropy, you have half of the particles in the direction of magnetic field and half the particles along opposite to the direction of magnetic field.
Actually, what I meant to say was, in that case, the system will be maximum disordered.
Yes.
Configuration can be anything. In the absence of the magnetic field, it is guaranteed that half of the spins will be in the lower energy state and half in the higher energy state. If we do not consider that spin half in a magnetic field, if we consider, let's say, a system, a two-level system, okay, and we have n number of particles. So the maximum disordered system can be half of the system in the lower energy state and half of the particles in the lower energy state and half in the higher energy state.
Okay.
It can be any configuration. It's just that the system will be maximum disordered. And the two extreme ends where all the particles point in the, let's say again, if we take that two-level system, if all the particles are in the lower energy state, then also the system is highly ordered, the entropy is zero. Again, when all the particles is in the higher energy state, then also the system is highly ordered. And entropy will again be zero. Now for any configuration, it can happen that, let's say 300 particles in the higher energy state and 200 particles in the lower energy state.
Okay.
Anything can happen. Yes, it's fine. Just the system will be maximum disordered.
Okay. Okay, fine.
So, Golam, you have any question?
No.
So I will stop recording and then I have to say a lot of things. I'm just stop recording.